أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Convert to Islam, O Muslims. This might seem to you as a very extraordinary topic, but I'll show you as you progress that this is a very relevant topic and Muslims of India as well as the rest of the world need to understand Islam and they need to convert to Islam. Even those who claim to be the most vociferous champions of Islam need to come on the path of Islam. And there is a big difference between what Muslims are doing and what Islam is. In fact, Muslims, by their acts and deeds, are responsible for the blemish that has come on the name of Islam in the last few centuries. I have created a new playlist on my YouTube channel by the name Muslims and the Straight Path. And in this particular segment, you will see the state of affairs that the Muslims are in at present. This was also the title of my first book on interfaith, which was published in 2010 and which talked about the problems affecting the Muslims in India and elsewhere and their probable solutions. I have been saying time and again that majority of Muslims today are so deeply engrossed in the problems that they do not see them as problem at all. Be it in India, be it in Pakistan, or be it in Arabia or North Africa or wherever Muslims are residing, they are far removed. In fact, majority of them, nearly all of them, are far removed from Islam. And you will see this once we progress with the lectures and we give you proofs of deviations. But since they do not agree to this, each one of them trying to prove that they or their belief or their sect is the greatest champion of Islam, they have been responsible for the attacks that have taken place on Islam on TV and through various media, because the others see it this way, that if Muslims are like this and they are claiming to be true adherents of Islam, then Islam too must be preaching all this. In fact, Muslims, through their conduct, have also been responsible for the attacks that have taken place on the persona of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The Christians, the Jews, or the Hindus are not against Prophet Muhammad. If they have gone ahead to tarnish the image of Prophet Muhammad, it is because of the aversion that they have for the present-day Muslims and the history that the Muslims boast of. I agree that some people with vested interests have been responsible for unleashing a propaganda drive against the Muslim. But the fact that they are succeeding is only because the rest of the people see some truth in what they are speaking. Through my books, I have tried to appeal to the saner intellectual class among the Muslims who should realize that it is time now to initiate self-assessment exercise, debate, and bring forth the suitable remedies for the severely inflicted mindset of their own Muslim brothers. My intention remains the same through these lectures as well. What I have been saying repeatedly is that the majority mass of Muslims today, and including their equally illiterate leaders, have reached to such nadir levels that they are incapable of analyzing the problems on their own, which inflict their community, leave alone looking for the ways and means to find a solution. Condition is so pathetic that collectively they are in a deep pit from where they are not even capable of coming out on their own. And an external solution, maybe in the form of an external helping hand, is surely needed to pull them out from those lower levels of deviation and degradation. Whoever sits down to find the solution should first address the plethora of problems that communities face today. The problems are so many that all cannot be described at one go. The problem of conservatism, of withdrawal, and of rehabilitation and whatnot. In fact, you will see as we move and proceed ahead that their understanding of religion too is vast, being far removed from the religion concluded by their Prophet Muhammad. Whereas modern education is the solution to enable them to live amicably with their Hindu brethren in the Indian society, more important is the need to provide the Islamic education that gives a real picture of true Islam rather than dogma-bound teachings of the distorted versions of Islam that has been taught to them. But the million-dollar question is, who will give them this education? I have been told that in the initial decades after partition, some bureaucrats in Pakistan had concluded that the only way to come out of the decadence that we are in was to put an end to all traditional systems of education, which teach hatred and a false pride in history that is concocted as per their whims, and replace it with a new set of education system. But the bureaucrat who brought the idea was transferred, and the matters remain same till date. Problems remain as they were, and in fact became worse with time. While Muslims continued to blame all the rest of the world and the various religions, be it the Hindus, the Jews or the Christians, as their enemies, they never looked within, never introspected, so that they could have come out of the pit, and never tried to find what are the solutions to their ailments which plague their community. Having said all this, it is the literate Hindus who must listen to what I am saying, and that too in national interests. They should keep in mind that the interests of the Muslims in India are not merely theirs. About 200 million Muslims, if left backward, will also inhibit the country from moving forward in its march towards global supremacy. The virus of militancy, if it spreads, will not allow the majority Hindus to live in peace. And even if this virus doesn't come into India, the very fact that they are backward, that they are working in contradiction to the pace with which growth is happening, will hamper the growth, will not allow India to move forward. Therefore, rehabilitation of Muslims in social mainstream is essential to India's interests and to the interests of all the citizens of India. This will only be possible if the saner minds in the Hindu community, instead of Muslim bashing, realize that it is the moral and national duty of every country-loving individual to strive and work for finding solutions for uplifting the downtrodden groups to whatever belief and religion they adhere to, including the Muslims and also other disadvantaged groups like the farmers, the Kashmiris, the Northeasterners, the tribals, the SCs, the STs, and the rest of minorities, and whoever is lagging behind and hindering the progress of India. It is strange that a community which ruled the world for more than 1,000 years has today reached a stage where it is incapable of getting up on its own. It has fallen in the pit of vices. Isn't it astonishing how quickly they have departed to the matters which made them decadent, and how rigidly they have adhered to matters which have kept them backward? Consequently, they have lost both ways, in the worldly affairs as well as in religious, and have thus passed from the center of the stage to the wings, where they continue to remain at present. As we progress, you will find that not just the Indian Muslims, the Muslim in general left true Islam way back in history. That is why, while Islam remains undoubtedly the best of faiths, Muslims are the worst of adherents. As Bernard Shaw used to say, he travelled across the Arab world, where he found Muslims but no Islam, while in Europe he found Islam but no Muslims. Several decades have elapsed since the time of Shaw. Matters have truly become far worse since then. True Islam has got lost in the innumerable deviated versions that the various sects, groups and subgroups call Islam. Each is far different in belief from the other. Each, while considering his own group to be the true follower of Islam, considers the other group to be wavered. In fact, there is not one sect or group today who does not consider itself as the true champion of Islam while labeling others as kafirs. I feel the Hindus have moments to feel satisfied, because if all the collective mass of Muslims call each other as kafir too, in fact, there might not be one sect among Muslims who is not called kafir by one or few sects. This is the level they have reached. They are all bashing each other in the name of sect, in the name of subsects, in the name of clans, in the name of languages, in the name of region. You ask them the meaning of the word kafir and they do not know. Yet they are busy calling each other as kafirs. All the sects of Muslims must realize that if all the rest of them are calling them as deviated, then they all are deviated. Some got deviated somewhere, the other got deviated at some other place. Satanic forces or the forces of Zulmat has left no stone unturned to deviate them wherever possible. It is time now that each one of us endeavor and try to search for the true teachings of Islam, which were concluded by Prophet Muhammad 1400 years back. Someone has to show them the mirror so as to enable their learned ones to find the real and true Islam, the straight path that leads them to God. And once they find it, they'll have to embrace it. The situation has got to such nadi levels that even the so-called experts of Muslim religion today were unable to see the terrorism being propagated by Osama bin Laden and others, and mince words when asked to label Osama bin Laden as terrorist. Take for example the case of Zakir Naik. He was seen by a good number of Muslims as the most learned person on interfaith and Islam, which he definitely wasn't. Dr. Zakir Naik is on record to voice views in support of Osama bin Laden, and for this reason was banned from entering the state of Uttar Pradesh first and the country of United Kingdom later. This mindset reveals the depth to which Muslims, not excluding those who are believed to be the learned ones, have fallen due to not learning from the past and paying no heed to the reformers who tried to show them the mirror. It is better late than never. Muslims of today will have to come out of this long-lasting march towards deterioration and disintegration, which has been suitably aided by the misinterpreted and misguided interpretations of Quran by the materialist and half-educated Maulvis and Mullahs. It is possible to understand the true teachings of the straight path when we make a sincere effort and attempt to find it. Detach from all moh, that is attachment and attractions, and having reason by our side. Putting our ego aside, anger, beliefs of the forefathers in which we have opened our eyes. Truth will glaringly present itself before our eyes if one endeavors sincerely, putting aside the past attachments and present aversions. Religion today has come on the streets, whereas it is evident from my lectures so far that the real religion is within ourselves. My attempt is not to criticize any thought or religion, because at this hour, all thoughts and religions are deviated from their base. And this is no attempt to point an accusing finger at any sect, because all sects, even those who may wrongly conclude that Sayyid Haider is vindicating their view, are grossly in error and misguidance. In no way the intention is to initiate a process of conversion, as there is no follower whose religion one may convert to. Rather, the attempt is only to find the truth, whatever it is and wherever we can reach upon. I have attempted to understand the true content of divine scriptures and to know what the divinities wanted our religion and our code of conduct to be, rather than the prevailing practices of molding the religion and code of conduct to suit our needs and desires. My endeavor is to show the extent to which the Muslims have digressed from true Islam. However, as I say this, fact remains that other faiths are not any less wavered. They too shall not feel elated at the criticism of the Muslims that I am doing. Because if they feel that way, this is because they are under the false notion that they are on the right. We all are under the false notion that we are on the right. Who do you think would know from heart that he is not on the right path and yet follow that path? So therefore, adherents of all religions, all sects, all subsects, all segments in society, howsoever diverse their beliefs may be, they all feel that they are on the right path. Fact remains that all of them are yet to understand what the true divine path is. Unfortunately, while we believe our scriptures to be from God, we try to give our colors to their understanding. Vedas are truly divine scriptures, but instead of understanding them for what they are, we try to understand their meaning from what we wanted them to be. Likewise, Jesus has called even the poorest subject as the Son of God, but we were hell-bent on proving Jesus, who undoubtedly had a relationship with God, merely to nourish our false pride and gain supremacy and superiority over other religions. We believe that Prophet Muhammad was divinely commanded to lead, but instead of paying obeisance to each and every command, our attempt is to interpret them so that he is seen to do what we want him to do. It is evident that we want even the Creator to act in the way we wish to see him act. This is despite the fact that the ceaseless cycle of birth and death presents a mirror for us to see our near future, which is just round the corner. Falling prey to such age-old devices to divert us from truth, we have been unable to attain salvation till date. As Surah Waqia of the Holy Quran says, there was a time when there were a lot many people who were moving ahead, who were attaining salvation. But in the end times, there will be only a few among all the Muslims and the rest of the humanity who will move on the path of salvation. Till when will we remain groping in the dark will depend on how early we are able to see and accept the true and the straight path which has been shown to us in the various divine scriptures that have been sent to us at different places and in different times among people who speak differing languages. But the message was one everywhere. We interpreted it differently. Somewhere Paramatma was being talked about, another place divine spirit was being talked about, and at some place the divine Ruh was being talked about. They all three are exact dictionary translation of one another. But we do not want to see it that way, because we have a feeling that our religion is better than yours. Therefore, adherents of those who revere Paramatma do not want to see divine spirit as the literal translation of Paramatma or the divine Ruh as the literal translation of the word Paramatma. Likewise, those who call Holy Ghost or the divine spirit do not want to see that other scriptures are also talking of a divine spirit which they are calling as Paramatma, or Quran is talking of Ruh which has been sent by God. It is clearly said in Quran that the Ruh is sent by God, and it was sent even on Prophet Muhammad. So it is evident the problem is not in the scriptures. The scriptures are talking about one and the same path. It is we who have translated and interpreted and commented upon in differently on subjects which were exactly the same, with the only difference that they were being given among a different set of people who spoke and understood a different religion.